You know where it's not. Are you ready to go?
Go.
Let's go. Oh, because people are never quite prepared for the rapid hand manipulation of the operator. Oh, the speed. Binding speed, I lost myself. Mm. They always let you win the first time.
No,
where is it?
Yeah.
Where is it?
Middle one.
No.
This one? Yeah. You think it's in the middle? So you have eyes. Don't try and be easy. Try and beat me. You know where the P is.
Right.
You know where it's not. You ready to go?
Yeah.
Oh, the speed, the blinding speed. I've lost myself.
The first one.
What, this one here?
Yeah.
Gosh, you're good at this.
Wow, Mary.
Why people lose at this game. The reason is because the P does not actually always stay under the shell it starts from.
Right.
That's right. Sometimes it actually moves from shell to shell. You don't see it because why? You're watching the shells.
That's in your head.
You're supposed to watch the P.
No, watch the hand.
Watch the shells. Because if you watch between the shells, you'll see that P actually move from one. Did you see that?
Yes.
It's so obvious. It's like it's got little legs like a clam. But that's because it's at half speed. At full speed, you can't see anything. I'll do it once at half speed, once at full speed. That way you have something you can compare. You ready? Here we go. Ready?
Yeah.
Whoa, the speed, the blinding speed. Did you see it?
Yes.
That's the one in full speed. That's the one in full speed. Now, folks, I'll tell you a little bit about the origins of this game. We don't know who invented it. Could have been a man, could have been a woman. We really don't know. The origins have been lost in the mires of time. So I can say just about anything that I want. This game was invented by a man. And his name was Throg. He was a Neanderthal fella. Played with half a coconut shell and this little white river pebble that he found on the beach. That was his favorite toy. One day as he was fooling around, as those Neanderthals were wont to do, he accidentally covered the pea with the shell into his primitive brain. It was as if that pea just disappeared in air. See, they didn't know about the persistence of objects. He looked all over, he couldn't find it. By accident, he lifted that shell, and there it was. I know, it wouldn't mean shit to me either. To a Neanderthal. To a Neanderthal, this was like a 2001 moment. This kept him occupied all afternoon. He took it back to the campfire and showed it to the other Neanderthals. It became the most popular game of the Neanderthal period, called the one-shell game. Now, as man's cranial capacity grew, the game lost a bit of its cachet. Till some genius Cro-Magnon man came up with with the idea of adding two more shells, thus creating what we would call a three-shell game, although they didn't play it the way we do today. They would just move these shells around to confuse people. This was before logic had been invented by the Greeks. Before logic was invented, people always bet on these two shells because they were the ones that were moving. I know, you can laugh, but before logic was invented, that would have made some kind of... Let's try and make this as simple as we possibly can.
Nothing to a modern man.
What? There are no modern men. Please, just fake it. All right, come up here. Let's try it again on a really test.
Oh, you're trying to get me.
Yes. Okay. No. I will make it simple. Yes. Put the shell on top of the peanut. Put the shell on top of the tea. Okay. That's put the glass on top of the shell. Excellent. See? Okay. See, this is fair. That's pretty easy. Fair. Hold your finger out like that. That's your thumb.
Oh, my thumb. You can't get it.
One of these two. Which one do you want?
Alright.
Turn that one over.
Yeah.
Okay, put a finger on that, put a finger on that. Now you have control. See,
right.
You know where the P is, you know where the it's not. Mm-hmm. You have control of two of the shells, you have 2-1 odds. This is what they call on the street a lead pipe cinch. On the street, people rip their pockets, taking every dime they've got, tossing it on the table, and they always look at you and they say stupid things.
Right.
Like, Pop, I've got you now.
Yeah.
But you would not do that, would you?
No.
Because why? Because why? Because you're an intelligent lady, and you know the instant a dollar hits this table, what's going to happen?
I'm
going to
win.
No. Like a little miracle, isn't
you
it?
Wow.
It's a shell game, folks.
I know you're shaking.
Well, I know we're getting a little late, but I got time for a couple more. Is that okay?
Yeah. Please.
Let me teach you how to do a trick. I hate to leave here taking advantage of folks. No, I ever get a clue. What have, do you mind if I take off this jacket? It's a little warm.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
Where can I get a suit like that?
What?
You want to get a suit like that?
Oh, you know, yeah, I'll sell you this one. Wait, I'll do it before I take this off. Let me show you a trick. Because in my pocket here, I have something. I'll show you how to do a trick. A magic trick. Well, I'm not saying real magic, but I'm not saying it's not either. I think I just have to do it for you. You have to figure it out for yourself the way I did. Now, folks, this trick uses a scarf, a silk scarf. It's white on both sides. And what we're going to do, place the scarf into the hand, like so. As the scarf goes into the hand, it comes out different. Goes in white, comes out red. It looks like magic. It looks like that white scarf is slowly changing into a red scarf. I know. It's not magic, baby. But it looks like that white scarf turned into a red scarf, but that's not what what happened at all. See, what happened was that I had two scars. I know, it's, now that you know, it's kind of silly. You have, when, backstage, when I was back in the room, I was busy stuffing this scarf into my hand. Like that. Now, what happens is you come out with this scarf. This is the misdirection. This is called palming. This is called misdirection. This hand is you have to be kind of casual because you don't want people to notice because it's closed in a fist. But this hand is misdirection. See. Everybody look at this hand. I don't want them to look at this hand. You can't show them that scarf. That gives us a trick away. I can do it. Now, we place the scarf into the hand like this. As it goes in white, but because you have that red scarf hidden inside, see? It's not red. Look, I know it looks like magic. It's just a silly trick. It's just a silly trick. It looks like magic. It looks like that white scarf is turning into a red scarf. It looks like magic, but it's a silly trick. I don't want to do that. And that's it. That's it. It looks like magic, but it's a silly trick. Once you know how, it's not so amazing, is it? I'll teach you one last trick before we go tonight. At one time or another, you've probably seen a magician take a piece of rope and cut it and put it back together again. I'm going to do the same thing, but once again, I'm going to show you step by step how it's done. Before we start, I'd like to have someone from the audience thoroughly examine this piece of rope, make sure it is, in fact, what it appears to be an ordinary, unprepared piece of rope. Would you, sir, go over every inch of that?
Come on, Poppy.
Okay, thanks so much. I'm kidding. Make sure there are no trap doors or mirrors. No hidden assistants.